that everyone else kind of watches. So everyone's following the Korean picks because they came first. Like, we didn't get to see like NALCS players like, here's the good champions. The Koreans go like, no, here's the good champions. And then those collide. Uh-huh. Just everyone's watching the Koreans being like, we're gonna learn from them. And so everyone's just playing the champions that are popular there. Without...
Who are the unicorns of love watching?
Dude, see, the unicorns are doing it right. They know how to really pick champions.
They're actually watching Cowsep, so they're watching Korean streams too.
They're watching solo queue streams. That's where their inspiration comes from. But I think it is interesting, you know, how the various regions come across what they think to be as popular picks, and then also what comes in mid-season. So Jarvan, again, Impaler, thinking that's a really important champion, even though this time around, Lee Sin isn't removed away.
Yeah, I mean, Jarvan right now, as we said before, he offers so much utility, and he actually doesn't have as hard of a time in the jungle as people thought he was going to have initially. Mm-hmm. Plus, I always like the cheese with any sort of champion who can gank at level 2 if you start one buff and then go immediately to put some pressure. We definitely did not see that. We saw the complete opposite, both junglers farming up, but it is always an option. Basically, junglers that are flexible, I think, are really good in this jungle.
No, we actually saw the exact opposite for St. Vicious. He farmed up in the jungle, got ganked at level 2.
Oh.
Or before level 2. It was a great steal, and hey, it helped him out a little bit. Maokai again for Haunster. Honestly, he had a great Maokai performance last game. I like going back for that one. But if you form Thrash as well, was still very good at that champ. So
yeah.
Nothing new for Chris Academy.
I was kind of hoping for Haunster to have a damage-oriented champion this time around, but having that main tank is always really strong. And as you said, Thresh again going to be a big one. Let's see if they run Blitzcrank back into it.
Well,
wow. Everything very, very similar here starting out.
Yeah, the only big difference being that Coast put a little bit higher priority on Lucian this time around. They picked the same two first champions, but Lucian got picked up right away, trying to deny that away from Cop. Still the Corki ban coming through.
Maybe Mash wasn't too happy with the way that 2 plus 1 turned out.
Might have been the case. I feel like in general, you're just like, you know what? Okay, well, Lucian's number 2, but number 3 is going to be Ezreal. And, I mean, it did work out for me.
Yeah, if you're
going
to 2 versus 1, Draven is the man to do it.
Manly version of that.
I don't feel like he'll lock it in, but it is an option.
I do like Sivir, though.
Yeah, it has actually gained a lot of popularity. I was talking to a bunch of the scrims at teams at IM San Jose, and in a lot of the scrims, Sivir's rising up in popularity. After you take out Lucian and Corki, you talked about the battle for third and what kind of AD carries are trying to fill in there. Sivir's a really good option, especially if you do have a main tank like Maokai and you have Pantheon. So this team is going to be great at chasing you down.
And it's just going to, it's going to help them kind of pick the fights they want to do. The man drops never quite seem to isolate Team Coast very much. It seemed like Coast was able to pick the fights they wanted to.
Uh-huh.
And now actually they've got a really good way to kind of kite back if they want. I like this team comp. They pick the same initial core, but they're picking a lot of different things around it. So Lucian's still a Kite AD carry, but Janna coming in, and probably, I think the Orianna Hover is the champion Jess is going to go for.
Yeah, Orianna's really safe, and since Keen has counterpick, it's really dangerous to have Keen with counterpick because, as you said, he plays so many different champions.
Yeah.
Go with something that you're comfortable being safe on, and if he plays something aggressive, then you'll still be able to get through lane.
And so he plays one of the safest mid laners. Haven't seen this guy in
another special for Jezz's.
Ziggs coming in, man. This is Jezz's playing his normal champion pool, but the Ziggs coming out there, I haven't seen that guy in like 6 months. I think he's a great champion, and look how good this team is at kiting back and playing long range.
Yeah. They've got the Ziggs Siege. They've got the Janna here. They have so many options. All right. We'll see what Curse want to run into it, and Keen specifically into Ziggs. Couple of things that you want to keep in mind. Yes, he has the AoE and he's going to be able to do a lot of damage to your champions and he can farm safely. Sometimes, get an assassin. I guess they just wanted to try snowballing here if they can get him roaming around. Well, it does fit in with the Sivir chase down squad.
Yeah, it's true. They've got a whole bunch of great ways to get at the enemy team. You've got to be a little bit concerned about your early laning phase just because Kassadin is super gankable, but that is the pick here. So Keen going to play Kassadin mid lane here up against Ziggs from Jess's. And I got to see what happens here. Like, I'm a little bit surprised to see, like, a self-sufficient mobile champion with Sivir.
Uh-huh.
Like, I feel like he maximizes synergy by, like, playing Olafs of the world and things like that. And, like, the Maokais who just, like, want to get into melee range. But, yeah, certainly this team is going to be able to chase guys down very effectively.
Also, they can kite really well as another option here. If Impaler does jump in,
Sivir ult and run.
They do have a couple of options here to move around. Kassadin, if he does get going, is really, really hard to deal with later because not only does he have his jump, but the move speed is really going to help him out.
You know what's risky about this, though? Is this is roughly the shortest range team you could possibly pick in League of Legends and still be part of the meta.
It is.
Like, I mean, okay, Thresh is more range than, like, Leona, but, like, It's the shortest range AD carry outside of Urgot. They've got to be kind of as a unit. They've got to go in together. The Moose Speed will help them glue that together. Moose Speed is very good on melee champions specifically.
All of that into Janna, though.
I know, and that's difficult. Janna's kind of considered anti-melee. Like, she's so good at messing with, like, the Udyrs and Synths of the world. You're adding more melee to that. It's a bit of a risk.
It's true. And we were wondering, you know, these are the top two supports, the Thresh and Janna. Pretty much going to be the go-to picks here for both sides.
And
was Soraka banned again?
I don't remember it being banned.
I don't think it was this time around. First game it was.
Yeah, first game it was banned, but we dropped the Lee Sin ban, and I believe we dropped the Soraka ban as well. And now right. Got the lineups as they are right here. But loading on into the Rift, guys, we're going to get ourselves into game two of this best of five. You're seeing Coast on your screen right now. These guys are up in game. They won game one. See if they can win themselves game two and game three to move on. On the other side of the Rift, though, Curse Academy looking to bounce back in this series. Best of five, winner plays Fusion for a spot in the North American LCS.
All right, so this time around, let's see if they do decide to try and get that early vision for lane swapping again. Because once again, they do have the Lissandra into Maokai option. Looks like everybody going standard here, though, and defensive wards pop up again.
Yeah, I like that ward a lot. Like, you just kind of spot the enemy mid laner, and you just go away.
Yeah, it's been really, really common placing those ones.
You put it too far forward, you give away 10 gold. Gotta be careful.
Delaying the trinket drops until almost the minute here for everybody. 155, so everything will, all the jungle camps will be spawned when those expire.
It's also worth noting it comes up in time to spot a 3-minute gank, which I guess is much less common now. Like, it's like a 220 gank, and then like 4 minutes is like the two core timings, but
you can still pull off like a 330 on a couple champions.
Yeah.
Pantheon is one of them.
To get level 3. I want a level 1 gank. Start shield bash.
That's extremely ineffective.
Probably.
You want to use your smite cooldown. The thing about the level 2 gank, just doing one buff and then going to gank, is you smite, then you go for your gank, and by the time you're done, you know, fighting wherever you ganked, you can go back and you can at least use your smite again to take another camp, even if you got chunked really low. And then you have enough gold to upgrade your jungle item. So it doesn't hurt you that badly. That's why I like those Pantheons and Jarvans.
But that's a good point.
Both of these guys, you know, have opted out of that. And we do have another lane swap here. Lissandra not going to meet up with Maokai. St. Vicious going to do the double jungle, this time with Bunny.
All right.
Maokai getting his classic Wraith camp start, or excuse me, Raptors.
It's fun.
Yeah, they don't really look like Raptors. I'm going to go with Razor Beaks.
Yeah, you're good with that one. And I believe, is that what they're actually called? Or are they actually called Raptors? I actually forgot.
They definitely look like birds, so I feel like it's Razor Beaks.
I want to say Razor Beaks as well. We're going to, it's probably, you know, I'm one of the guys who said Needly for like 3 years and everyone hated me for it. Yes. I actually want to make sure I'm correct and annoying people and not just annoying people and being wrong. So I'll look that up when I get home tonight. But Coast going to go ahead and stay on the bottom side of the jungle, realizing that, well, our opponent's lane swapped on us, and Blue Buff's going to go to Impaler.
Yeah, look at the difference, though. We got Mash here just shoving into turret, so they quickly push the lane here for Team Coast, getting some early turret damage, trying to kill off the wave, get another dragon started up here.
Ooh.
Oh, man, everybody gets hit with the AoE. They need to juggle it from now on, because that was pretty big, and one of the bad things about dragon, early on, it takes a long time to kill.
Yeah.
But also, if you take a couple hits like that, having to return to base after early dragon, you're so far down in experience. Chris still going to be level 1, and he'll be very vulnerable going into something like this. Hanser already level 2 here. Let's see what they can do. Maybe they'll shove this turret really quickly, because, as we said, Mash already quickly shoved the first wave.
Honestly, pretty good stuff then. So, really, there are two key farming members still got to stay in lane for all that from Team Coast.
Uh-huh.
Like, Jessa didn't leave and Mash didn't leave. The other guys don't really get a lot of income anyway, so, you know, fairly low opportunity cost dragon here. The exception being that at least Bunny gets to share XP with Cobb.
Yeah, the only thing is there was more experience going over to Curse Academy because they were taking jungle camps, which provide way more experience than taking that dragon.
That's
also, you can take them a lot quicker. So, if the difference does actually matter something, it's going to be that level discrepancy here.
And Hanser right now sitting at level 3, St. Vicious 3 as well. Those guys are a bit bigger, but Coast Going to group up now with their level 2s, and they're going to go for the early turret pickup. So now, not only did they get first dragon, they got first turret kill as well. So a bunch of gold going to this team.
All right, we'll see what they can actually buy with this gold. Early move here from Curse Academy as well towards the mid lane. Once again, I really like how Jezzes plays these lane swaps. He always plays really safe. He's on Zig, so he has an escape that he doesn't have to use a summoner spell. And he sort of draws over so much attention from Curse Academy. Once again, they use up a lot of time mid. Now he's got flashed on, though.
Flash slow, Lander comes out just to make sure something's okay. Jezzes will flash away, gets stunned by St. Vicious anyway.
Doesn't get the hit off.
Flash hook's going to land. He predicts the juke as well. Jezzes will be going down. First blood comes in.
So that's 1, 2, 3 summoner spells burned. No answer yet from Coast.
Uh-oh, Impaler maybe overextends. Actually, yeah, wow. Burns his flash, gets ignited for it.
That's a good trade there for Curse Academy. They expend a lot of flashes getting the kill, but they get one back there too. So first blood, definitely worth it. And they made their investment mid work out, because if that had not worked out, so much wasted time. That was going to be really poor for them. This whole time, though, of course, both AD carries were farming contently. Cop, because he froze his lane, is going to be able to stay up there. And we will see what Mash can do. He's gone back and got that pickaxe, so he'll try and shove it into the turret to get it to bounce back.
The interesting thing, though, is, again, Dragon's not worth very much gold, or really any in this case for him. And he actually bought Boots of Speed. So he actually spent 1,200 gold in that back. So Cop's not far away from being able to buy BF Sword in his recall.
So, yeah, the dragon's not worth gold, but it is instant combat power for him.
Yeah, he's getting about 10 attack damage from the buff itself, so he's actually going to be close to parity if he does face a BF sword. Yeah. We'll see if this pans out there. Cop about 3 waves away from being able to afford that item, depending on how well he last hits here. This is going to be a small item deficit for him because he hasn't backed yet.
Now, interesting choice here by Impaler to go up top. It leaves Chris to just kind of deal with the consequences of what happened down bottom. It's going to be Haunter, that level 5 Haunter with a giant minion wave. Haunter plays defensively because he has no vision. Up top, Impaler's not able to get anything. And the jungler shows, so that means that Haunter can now shove this wave all the way into the turret.
And feel safe about it, exactly. Now, it was a flash lost by Cop, so at least there's some kind of gain here. And in fact, with Cop Force Recall, it's a lot of turret damage up here with a new wave coming in soon.
Upcome reinforcements. Saint able to use the early Razor Beak Smite to find a ward. And as we said, you know, he's level 5, so he also has experience advantage because of that early dragon. Maybe that will show itself in the terms of first Pantheon gank, first ultimate, might be targeted up top, where the duo is.
Question is, how well can Sheep predict the landing with the tornado? Because you can actually completely stuff that stun and get far enough away from the knockup that nothing happens to you. And if Sheep can make the plays, it's a good place for him. Kian, good early damage there, and heck, with the mana, the magic damage shield doesn't even take any counterattack damage.
Yep, true to form. Jez is able to just farm very safely with Ziggs. Kassadin, though, going even here. Pretty strong for him. We'll see if he's able to get rolling, because that will be a big part of this team. Ooh, Haunter able to find Sheep, trying to go for a ward. And Saint does not have flash.
Only level 4 gets the 3-man knockup, but Kian can't get across the wall there, so nothing picked up there. And all is well.
Well, they got one flash there. I guess Janna flashes something.
Yeah. 4.5-minute cooldown. Really important. But Jess is forced to play so incredibly far back. No summoner spells at all. His heal's still down. His flash is still down. He's now actually getting out CS by the cast. Gonna look for the buff steal, though.
Oh,
he's gonna get it. Jess's from downtown.
Straight blind, too. Oh, no, he has a ward there. Okay. I thought that was more impressive than it was, but
still impressive.
Still really hard to time that.
Awesome, awesome stuff done right there. And St. Vicious loses his third buff to the enemy team so far this series.
Ouch. All right, so let's see here. Now that he's taking the extra blue, that's going to be pretty big for Team Coast. We'll see if he can actually capitalize on that in terms of mid control, because now he's going to be able to spam out bombs towards this Kassadin. It'd be a huge point for Impaler to work off if Jezzes can actually take control.
It's actually incredible to me how well the laning has been, though, from Curse Academy, because Coast got a free, they got the dragon. And the turret, Chris now in a bad spot. Claw not going to be much. Saint takes him down. Great gank top lane.
Yep, level 6 very, very quickly there for that Pantheon. Jarvan still working on his. One kill did show top, but Dragon still takes fairly long to complete. They might be able to get in there and contest. Looks like Thresh working around to try and get vision at least.
Yeah, their bot lane's there. They've got teleport and Saint's running down.
That blue Ziggs though, so much zone control around Dragon.
Oh, teleport really short window. Are they going to rush this down or not? 1200 health. Saint's coming down in a second though. Can they burst it? 600 health. The spike comes in time. Two dragons, but now Coast going to lose a lot of members. It's going to be a, looks like 2-0. Jess is going to make that 3 if Cop can land the shots. Flash comes in from Kassadin. He's still not dead, but the Rift locks up in a second.
They want to give that kill to Kassadin anyway to try and get him rolling. One kill, 3 assists here for Keen. That should be enough to complete a route of beats.
Wow, so now 5 kills to nothing for Curse Academy. All Coast has is objective control, but the gold is bleeding away.
Yeah, and look at the ridiculous ward coverage they got as well. All Curse Academy invading on that red side. It's completely warded. They're going to take down a turret on the back of it. Huge gold lead, 5 kills. This is going to be a massive, massive amount of control. They're going to have to use it, though, to rotate up and get the last remaining outer turrets, not go for those ridiculous dives. Because, as you said, really short-ranged here, so it's hard for Curse Academy to actually take turrets. We'll see if they can pick somebody off moving through that jungle that they just warded instead of just sieging up straight out of turret. All right, so here's the hook onto Jez's. Buys him some time. Impaler's able to get off the smite before he dies here, but as you saw, they're able to clean up pretty quickly.
Yeah. Remember, Sheep lost his flash from about 2 minutes ago when he got caught in the lower jungle. He would have lived too if it weren't for that. So the summoner spell burn ended up paying off.
Ooh. Cop thought about going for finishing off the kill, but they give it to Keen.
And
he does complete the Rod of Ages. That is huge for them.
11 minute
Rod on this Kassadin.
Wow. Yeah, he is going to be doing quite well for himself here. Jess does want the Athene because he wants the magic resist, thanks to the plenty of magic damage against him in the matchup and in the enemy team, but still uphill road for him. He's pretty far behind in gold. I mean, 75 minions in 11 minutes as Ziggs, it's a pretty low score.
He is definitely going to continue to be on the defensive. They've actually called up Janna here to help support the turret. Keen, with the blue buff on top of Rod of Ages completed, has no fear. You can see he's playing really far up in the lane here. Haunter down bottom does not have teleport, by the way, so Chris does have the advantage there. Haunter can't stop him.
Problem is Chris just so far under farmed, and in fact, Haunter's getting a different item going in here. He's actually going for the Righteous Glory. I'm excited about that one. So new build, they really, really want to hard engage. He changes his build based on the team comp. I like it.
Yeah, nice change in the build there, but as you said, you know, the difference in experience. This is, again, the early dragon. It's such an investment. It doesn't seem like it's that big of a deal, but being down in levels is really, really difficult for a top laner like that. And he's also down in CS, so it's really, you know, it just kind of piles on and snowballs into a huge, huge problem. Now the whole team can go to that point where they know they have the advantage down here. Chris is vulnerable.
Oh, Saint's going for the dive right now. The Lissandra does have ulti. Knocks up himself, actually. Haunter's going to pull aggro and has got nowhere to go. So 1-0 for Coast pretty cleanly.
Yeah, getting a little bit ahead of yourself there. Lissandra's probably the worst champion to dive under a turret, especially the turret that gives you a shield.
Oh, God, yeah.
Because not only does she go invulnerable, but she can lock you in under the turret, as we saw there. And they do pay for their hubris.
One thing I wanted to point out is you're talking about the level advantages. A level is worth way more stats than the dragon buff. Like the 8% like AP AD, until very, very late game, you just get more attack damage by being a higher level. And your abilities do way more damage by leveling up them than 8% of your ability power is going to. So yeah, you actually do fall behind immediately by dragon that early.
Yeah, and that's even after the stat squishing too. Being higher level, very big.
All right, well, 3,000 gold deficit. This blue buff not stolen away. Keen's going to get that. Level 9 on him. Athene's was finished now by Jess, so he has some more stats to deal with, to work with. He's got some more things to do. But Cop has been out farming, and Haunt has been out farming, and so you just have more, like way more individual power on Curse Academy.
All right, so we've agreed. Curse Academy, they do have the upper hand now. What are they going to do to finish this game out, though? Because they do not have the team that can break through a Lissandra and Ziggs wave clear.
Oh, you're right.
Even Lucian. So really what they have to do is continually move across the map. They have to keep switching lanes and clearing out all the wards. They have a perfect team for catching people out when you switch back and forth between lanes. So if they can keep on switching their pressure top to mid, and eventually catch somebody out, then they work off of that pick to actually take down a turret. It's going to be slow going, though. I mean, this is not going to be a quick game. They really have to take advantage of the map movement here and the advantage in mobility that they do have. Janna, though, provides quite a bit of mobility herself.
Well, copying the same thing, though. Haunter comes on in. Actually, she misses the ulti, does not knock back Haunter, and he goes down right away. TP comes in from Chris. Knockup misses the ulti, comes in, though. Haunter still, okay, just now burns his flash, but now Saints on the kind of the wrong side of this one. Oversends himself. Very low health. Oh! The Q comes in. The Ziggs ulti doesn't quite catch him, but two kills picked up all the same. Overextension by Curse Academy.
All right, teleport comes in. They get the kill. This is going to be another outer turret down, but Kassadin is on the way. Lissandra ultimate already used, so she's actually fairly vulnerable right now. They don't have vision inside the bushes. Don't go overly aggressive.
All right, and out they all go, but look at this. Jess is getting some free time in the mid lane. Gets rid of most of a wave. Sudden life is difficult. There's the jump on in. Flashes in Keen right on top of Jess. The flash does not go over the wall. Dodges the hook, yep. But he has nowhere to go. Sheep's coming on in. Can he do enough, though? There's the knockup. Shield already used, I'm pretty sure. And Keen gets the kill anyway. Nice move, Bunny Fufu.
This is the main thing for Curse Academy. When you talk about moving around the map, the person that they're trying to get fed is the Kassadin. And he just got another kill. Needlessly large rod already in inventory. So he's going to be a huge part of tracking down those kills if they're able to control that vision.
Very nicely done. Bunny Fufu going to take a couple of 100 hit points of damage, but I guess life moves on. And here we go. Dragon attempt now. Number one for Curse Academy. Impaler is over the wall. Does have smite. Does have flash. Will he look for it? Yes, does
it again.
Get it, though. Nice pick up there, Curse Academy. Dragon's theirs, and out they go.
So he's not able to get it this time, but they do have to burn a flash as well. Now, for Team Coast here, it's all about, you know, that wave clear. Ziggs, people kind of forgot about how long he can stall out a game. So we'll see if they're able to retain control of one blue buff even, it will be huge for Coast and they can buy some more time. All you need to do is buy time for a mistake from Curse Academy. If they can wave clear long enough for Curse to get anxious and overextend a bit, they've got a great team for punishing some mispositioning.
And we've seen that time and again, that like the dives get punished really hard when they over kind of step their bound. The counterattack damage super high here. Coast going to play defense for a little while. Curse Academy, as you said, going to look to play the rotations game. Haunter does have the teleport lead, so that could be part of it. Impaler doesn't find anything top lane. St. Vicious grabs his red pretty safely. And we might just wait for the next sort of item spike to come in before Curse Academy does anything crazy.
Yeah, as you can see, Saint just farming up. On Pantheon, you have that luxury. You can just, as long as you're farming the jungle in the right quadrant of the map, you can still jump to any action. And so if the team does find somebody, he's still ready with his Pantheon ultimate and he can join up. But at the same time, he's still farming the entire time. So he will get tankier and he can get to be that front line along with Haunter so that when he does initiate with Pantheon ultimate and jump in like that, he won't be 100%, even if he is a recipient of a Lissandra ultimate. He needs to get to that point where they can't burst him down.
And that's one thing that Saint did very well, especially in game one, was he managed to out-farm Impaler for most of the game there. This time the CS is a lot more close, but it's still something that I think Saint's done a good job of, is always kind of getting his farm as a jungler.
Interesting focus up top here, because once again, it is Lissandra. He does not have his Zhonya's though, so he only would rely on his ultimate.
Oh man, here comes Pantheon. Not a happy place to be if you're Chris. He's going to ult St. Vicious to try to buy some time for his team to kill him, but not going to happen there. Now Sheep gets hooked in, flayed as well. Ooh, great ulti. Will it be enough to stay alive? Looks like yes.
Sometimes the jukes, you actually just run into your opponent, hoping that they will predict you running away. Mm-hmm. And so it looks pretty funny sometimes because it looks like you're just running straight into hooks and stuff like that. But it's all about the mind game of those jukes.
And, you know, it worked out. Sheep's going to be okay. Chris, unfortunately, did go down for this one. And Curse Academy looks like they will get a blue buff for their troubles. Sweep the ward. Six!
Oh, my! Nope.
Saint got it.
So close.
Saint got it with the crit from the auto attack. Q auto takes the blue.
They're circling around, too. See if they can do anything mid. As we said, super short range. Really difficult for them to get through any sort of defensive from Coast. Janna, Ziggs, Lissandra, what a tower defense team. You have to be in position, though.
I'll see what they can do with this one. Impaler is around. Easy wave clear by a cop. Actually, chugging a mana potion to keep his mana pool nice and up.
Really underrated buying mana potions for AD carries. The other thing, actually, there were, I guess it changed in 421, but in 420, some junglers like Fiddlesticks, a lot of top Fiddlesticks guys were actually skipping the jungle item, and you just buy a couple mana potions all game long. And it's actually extremely efficient because jumping up to the early Zhonya's was really important.
But
other than that, mostly AD carries. Ziggs got a couple mana potions himself. Cop with a very, very quick use of defensive abilities here.
Yeah.
And he uses ult to run.
And you saw Chris also realize, like, my opponent's going to spell shield this. Didn't ult, he just burned his Q.
Yeah.
And was like, all right, yep, your reflexes are good enough. I tested that. Not going to try for that one at all.
Small win. Get the ultimate cooldown as well.
Yeah. It's a good one there. Now, the interesting thing is, again, the Curse Academy team is so short range, and you're running into Lissandra and Jarvan and Ziggs. Hitting turrets is really hard for Curse Academy.
As I said, this is not going to be a quick game. They have to keep on fighting over neutral objectives and trying to control vision so they can get those engages.
All right, Dragon number 5, it's the goal. They've got one.
Well, Baron is also alive. You can see the early importance there already, even at just 20 minutes, putting a bunch of wards up there just because they're so afraid.
This team is pretty good at it. Again, the auto crits from Pantheon, anything below 1/5, I believe it is. Below 20% health, you get the auto crits. Sivir, just generally decent DPS as an AD carry.
I think it's 15%.
15%, okay. I remember when we were first making Pantheon, there was a lot of feedback in internal playtests that last hitting was too easy on the champion because the auto crits.
Well, yeah.
The thing is, doing the math, you almost could never kill anything but a cannon minion from an auto crit that wouldn't have died anyway. So it was just teaching people to last hit.
Uh-huh.
Because it's like, oh yeah, hit things when you're low to get the crit, which conveniently is also the last hit for you, but like,
and then there's
just Zed. Okay. Where it's like really free. Or you support players with a Targon's Brace.
Oh yeah,
400 health window. Oh,
you like that new change?
I think it's good. Thresh players still have to be skillful though, so them I respect.
So Bunny gets her respect.
Yep. Sheep doesn't hit enemy champions. Like whatever, that's easy.
Yeah, I mean you can see here. All they're doing is trying to move from one lane to another. They're trying to pull Coast into a vulnerable position, but if they can't do it, ooh, Haunter actually is the one in a vulnerable spot. He gets caught out. He's surrounded.
Mid alone flashes away, is going to stay safe, but there's three guys bot lane able to push, but they're not going to go for it. Maybe they were afraid of Baron going down, but bot lane is available to Curse Academy right now.
I mean, Dragon's up in 10, so this is basically a Curse Academy Dragon. It's just theirs for the taking. Saint can solo that easily without taking any damage. It leaves the rest of Curse Academy to try and run them off this Baron. A lot of pings down onto the Baron because they know this Dragon's coming up and they want trade for it. Oh!
Impaler misses E.
Miss! That could actually cost them. I don't think they can even continue doing this now. A huge amount of damage taken from the AD and support.
Well,
I mean, they have that vision control. But man, all right, so it doesn't cost them because Chris Guy may have no idea, but
yeah.
did look silly doing it.
Coast, looks like we're gonna be okay. Impaler losing a bunch of health, but I think they're gonna make it just in time.
Mash goes into tank it.
Early smite, but he gets it.
Now, it's a pretty good trade-off right there. They invest a whole bunch of money into controlling the Baron because they know we cannot fight over these neutral objectives.
Oh,
and Curse Academy, just like clockwork, are to go back to this dragon over and over. So they say, okay, our only one chance is to try and trade an objective. And the one secret objective besides dragon that they could go for, taking the Baron, it definitely paid off. And a really smart move by Coast there, taking advantage of the predictability of Curse Academy.
And look at this. Look how bad Cop's wave clear is against these minions. Trying to knock them down with Ricochet when those melees are just so durable against it. And again, that's the only ranged champions they have. Like, Kopp is the only wave clear in this team. A dedicated siege is going to be really hard for Curse Academy to hold.
Yeah. Maokai can do his best, but it's going to be a lot on Kopp, and he does not have Static Shiv completed. He might try and turn that Zeal into a Static Shiv just because of the sneaky Baron here from Coast.
Yeah, I mean, Shiv's the right choice, I think, on Sivir anyway, but definitely,
No Phantom Dancer for her.
I just think it's more, like...
She does move very quickly.
Yeah, like, generally speaking, if you're able to move between attacks more, like, Shiv tends to be a little more valuable, and it just complements her, or supplements, I should say, her general kit in the first place. Just AOEing things down.
Do you like Phantom Dancer on anybody?
Yes, I really like it on like Tristana, Caitlyn, like anyone who's like super, super auto attack focused, and just kind of sits there being a turret. Because actually, the extra 10 attack speed and 10 crit is worth actually a lot, like way more than the lightning. And so it's actually optimal DPS.
I mean, it's really efficient.
Yeah, it's super efficient for 200 more gold. So,
yeah. Just checking, making sure that dragon is gone. All right, so they got one turret with this Baron buff.
And it still lasts 4 minutes in this patch. They got plenty of time.
Yeah. And Baron does still give gold, so.
Yeah, 1500 total, right?
Much more than the dragon.
25.
Yeah. Little bit gold of a discrepancy right there.
Like a 90-1 ratio or something.
Still pretty deep in the hole, though. So Chris Academy just going to try and wait out that Baron. Hopefully, they're going to try and not give up any more objectives. But as you said, really strong, empowered cannon minions coming through. And there's the SAG ship coming in for a cop, so that will help out quite a bit.
Yeah, that's definitely a pretty big deal. Also, the fact that Keen is still able to split push pretty effectively. Now, to keep in mind, Chris does have teleport, but I believe Cassid and Q will interrupt the teleport channel. I think it interrupts the channel.
That's the one thing they kept. It's the same thing with like LeBlanc.
She's not
able to silence anymore, but hey, it'll interrupt channels.
Okay, yeah. So Chris can't freely teleport away from this, otherwise it would have been a nice TP advantage. So instead, it's actually kind of required to be a 4v4, as long as Keen keeps his Q cooldown in mind. I'm just still surprised that they're kind of allowing Cop to wave clear here, and the team doesn't want to play aggressively. I suppose they don't think the stats they're getting from Baron are enough to overcome the gold deficit.
Uh-huh. I mean, it still gives that attack power and attack damage, so...
But at this point, it's like only 22 AD and AP, because it's a very early Baron buff, yeah. So... It's still worth, like, 400 to 800 gold a person, though.
All right, so from the passive play here of Coast, this is going to be a fairly extended game. I do like that early trade, though. I mean, the one thing they can count on is Curse Academy constantly going for these dragons on spawn, and they made basically the one window really count there to keep them in this game. And once again, it is about waiting for this short-range team to make that mistake.
Yep.
You know, eventually somebody gets a little antsy because you feel like you're in control of the game and you want to take advantage. And if you step too deep, especially under secondary turrets, the game can easily turn around really fast.
And keep in mind, all they gave away was dragon number two.
Yeah.
Chris, gotta be, I mean, 4 minion damage is nice, but they already had dragon one. It's not dragon three number yet. Those are the ones that really give combat stats for champion versus champion combat. So it was kind of like a safe dragon to give away.
Number three, though, would be really scary to give more move speed already the
rotation-heavy, melee-heavy team.
Yeah,
that's like the most important dragon for that team.
Good vision control, though, so maybe Coast can make a play on topside. I really like this establishing a lot of wards around topside before making the play. Now they've invested everybody up there. Can they capitalize? Hanser knows really, really steep right now.
Oh no! He's getting spotted out. Now can he get away? Flashes, burns the W. Burns?
Right, just glory.
He did. Well, it wasn't on cooldown, but it's because you can reactivate it. So I looked and it was like, it's not ticked down. That's right. It's a double activate item. That's why I stopped. I knew it's called.
I'll never forget now.
Yeah, I heard your conversation about that at IAM. It's not Kale's E.
They snuck another turret here. So Coast, though, they're slowly chipping away, getting a couple more turrets down for the team. Still, Ziggs, the turret defender.
Also, how long Cop had to hit that thing.
Up.
Yeah, it's still pretty dangerous for these guys. And of course, keep in mind, if Janna's ever there to defend the turrets, they die even slower. And here's the engage. They want this bot lane one more time. Mash very alone right now. Good flash, but Keen's still there. The flash engage. Saints got him. That's a 1-0.
All right, they make a move around the map. They take the kill bottom. Coast is going to try and answer at mid, though. Shove the turret hard. This is the wave clear champion for Curse Academy, though. Cop rips through the minion line, and they have to abort mission.
Dragon's now in 5 seconds. Ulti pop by Cop. They want this. Wow, actually managed to haste through the minefield.
Nice zigs.
Flash
Satchel
justice.
Right there.
All right.
Satchel's back the Maokai, so he cannot twisted advance.
Yeah.
Mid turret gets cleaned up, though, and Dragon should be cleaned up shortly thereafter here for Curse Academy. That would be the third dragon if they're able to finish this one. Impaler would have to steal it again. And this time, well, he does have flash, so
yeah,
he can go for the exact same move he did last time. No ward behind dragon. Oh, the bomb did extra damage to it. There's not going to be time.
Yeah, not going to get that one in time. Unfortunate there, Jess is trying to help, doesn't quite do it. So dragon number three goes over to Curse Academy. They are now heavily in control. They grab the Scuttler for fun. Cop's going to run fast instead of recall.
I kind of like the, you know, changes here. If you want to have a short team like this not good at sieging at all, as long as you can control team fights for the whole game, just continually stack up dragons. Even giving up a Baron, Curse Academy is still in control.
Yeah, an eventual Baron will give you siege. It gives you, like, literal siege minions. Oh, they go the other way, and they look for Bunny Foo Foo. Down he goes. Fight starts. 4v5. Sheep in the middle of it all. Gets a nice route there from Chris, but the tank line, quite durable from Curse Academy. It's going to force Coast back, actually, off this one.
So they got one kill, but they can't really push anything in right now. Baron is
top
up.
Top lane's got a good wave, but they don't go for it.
So they can actually buff up the vision that they have around this side, but that's about it. Curse Academy is going to have a hard time clearing out all those wards, though. Saint's going to need to smite the... What do we settle on?
The Razor Beaks.
Yeah.
Think. Now, good red buff on Cop. That's cool.
Is it? I love it on tanks now, that it regenerates health.
Oh, yeah. 1% oh, man. Per 5.
If I was Haunter, I'd be all over that red buff.
I just still feel like the slow is just so darn useful. It's like a lot of damage and like range damage have really high uptime on it.
Yeah.
I don't fault you.
I'm a melee player.
Yeah, if you were going to take my red buff, I'd let you. But that's only because I like you, not because I think you're right.
Ah, thank you so much.
I don't know. You actually might be right about this one. I don't really know.
Well, I guess you'd have to do the math here and see exactly how much health Hanzo is regenerating, because it is ridiculous. You get a full 1%.
He's probably getting about 4 to 6 health per second.
All right. Again, everybody's back alive. Bunny's back on his feet. Everybody groups up once again. They're trying to clear out the vision and a really aggressive initiation here.
Oh, what are they going to go in for this one? There's the ulti popped in by Chris, and Haunter just kind of holding up the front line. That is a top laner, not quite traded. Haunter survives this one. Saint Vicious blocking the culling to keep his homie alive. Nicely done there.
Keen on the side still. He's threatening Mash, so keeping that very low mana AD carry.
Yeah.
Back
he goes.
Means that they cannot chase him down.
They clear a minion line, they trade a 1 for 0, and no objective gains really created here. Much lower kill game, a lot of action, just people don't quite die.
Yeah, really tough. Coming away with one kill, counter push mid here from Coast. They can get an objective.
Oh, wow, nicely
Cassidy
done. Yeah.
Cassidy can close in here, though.
All right, Sheep low on health. Haunter with a nice teleport as well. He's going to cut them off. They have to go far right. Coast realized this. They still run fast. The thing is that Janna move speed is matching what Dragon gives Haunter. I think Jess has to stay in the
yeah,
radius.
Yeah, you just have to stay close enough, though.
Sheep leaving him out to dry. There we go. Turns back.
So they're able to escape, but now the counter push. Every time you chase somebody off, get them low. They have to recall. Curse Academy take control of mid lane. They're the ones with the short range, though. Be difficult for them to try and actually chip away at the turret. So instead, go for ward coverage. The never-ending battle of wards up on the top side by Baron. Bunny Foo Foo doing his darndest. Once again, stacking up these lockets here for Curse Academy.
And they really like getting more than one of them here.
This time only two, though. Two is not that bad.
I think it's acceptable, yeah.
Yeah.
And none of them are new. Although, actually, you could totally get away with buying Banner of Command and Haunter.
I actually,
AP tank.
Yeah, one of those being Banner would actually be pretty good because they have a hard time sieging.
Yeah.
So that would help out.
It would not die to Ziggs. It would only be Lucian who could even deal meaningful damage to it. And when you get Baron, like, stuff gonna die. Well, Chris Academy not doing that just yet to aid their sieging, but could be an option for them.
I feel like we're missing something because they did it again. I feel like there's a bug or something that it doesn't overlap.
I mean, it's definitely a unique passive aura. I know the shield is only worth half value the second time around,
it's
like with Summoner Heal.
It's reduced 50% unless something changed.
I mean, it's 190 point shield, so you get like 300 health shield this way, and it can make people like survive, like the Lissandra Ziggs.
And it still will double stack on the people holding the item, right?
Right.
All right, so both the main tanks still get double the magic resistance.
Yeah, basically Aegis 1 is worth 5 Aegises. Aegis 2 is worth 2 Aegises.
Yeah.
That's 40% value, but hey, not horrible. And there we go. Another ward goes down. Curse Academy have reclaimed vision control over this. Coast
Here's the
careful.
Pick. This is the situation that you want with this team. They're all about jumping through Fog
oh,
of War.
Oh, Sheep, why would you face check that? Down yeah. he goes.
Well, they just leave you with so few options. Control all of the vision. That's a better option, actually. Flag.
They're
going to kill
flag
you.
Over the
There's
wall
your
on
option
a tank.
Right there.
One of those things, but not going to happen here. So, Curse Academy now in control. Zigzaldi comes down. Jess is forced away, though. Keen zoning out the team by himself, but the re-engage comes in. They found Chris. Chris ults himself, but he's going to go down. Jess is as well in the flash engage. Saint Vicious is going to look for Mash here. Takes a whole bunch of damage, though. So far, a 3-for-0. Saint on the rebound, though. Can he drop down? Mash does land the auto attacks. 3-for-1 make it. Coast back off, so does Curse Academy.
That, they pretty much just illustrated what we've been talking about, though. How this is the team that wants to control the map and make plays off of that rather than trying to siege up the turrets. They immediately don't hesitate to jump off of Baron. They're all just about getting those Fog of War picks, and they clean up a couple more kills, move down to Dragon, because number five gets closer and closer.
Yeah.
Hey, I changed it.
No, you got it. No, you're right. Number five gets closer. Number four is on the way to that number. Unless you count backwards.
Ooh, taking a couple hits from Dragon here, though. They are getting chunked pretty low. Impaler in the area, so this is his to smite. Saint Vicious still dead with no ultimate. Wouldn't even be able to get there.
Well, Impaler in a duel against Cop has to run away, and it's his. Nicely done. Picked up there by Team Coast. Three Dragons apiece. The great hook on the Sheep, though. Bunny, Fufu, and Hans are coming in now. Chris got slowed, forced to flash away.
Keen low on mana.
Another engage comes in. So much damage. Bunny, Fufu barely surviving. A whole bunch of shields on him.
Ooh, stacked them up there. So they do come away with one kill, but a very important dragon steal here for Coast. And they're actually tied up now. So it's 3-3 on those dragons.
Wow, this is an incredibly close game. Just like over in game one, these guys keep treading objectives. And advantage is back and forth. Really good by Coast. They're able to force them back and get them back in on sort of regroup around Dragon to pick it up. And so now, does Coast feel like they're more powerful now? Do they feel like they can actually take fights on their own terms without stabbing people at Dragon?
Doesn't quite look like it. I mean, they do have really important Void Staffs that they got really early on both their double AP carries. But it's still going to be very hard to fight in the open terrain here. Saint Vicious gets picked, so that's a good way for them to start out.
Nice hit of Nakas, but he's still got half health right here, and it's going to be Impaler getting dropped down by a cop. Chris does jump away.
Yeah, Chris is Uma and that Lissandra, so no threat there. Baron control, vision control, Curse Academy going to be able to force this.
And now life's pretty good if you're Curse Academy. The enemy jungler is dead. You're going to catch out the kill on a Mash as well. They're trying to force this one back. They didn't make it happen. Keen is just a workhorse right now. 4-0-8 is Dragon. Should be picked up. A 3-0 happens overall. Keen's going to survive this, I'm pretty sure. Pops his Onias. Rift walks next. They didn't even try to kill him. Dragon goes securely to Curse Academy.
And Baron, too. So now they can see Jug.
That's what I meant to say.
You weren't wrong.
Well, no.
Oh, you were wrong.
The last dragon went to Coast. Man, I'm horrible at this.
All right. There's the Baron buffed up minion.
Oh, man. And they catch Sheep. That's four kills in a row, plus Baron, plus a turret. Curse Academy crushing now later in this game.
Now, this has to make you wonder. Okay, so they are going to be able to steamroll in through the base here because everybody's dead. And they should probably be able to take down Inhibitor. But you have to start wondering, is the map control the new meta now? Just trying to get the team with the best 5v5 and could try and control the Rift until you can stack up the Dragons and the Barons? Because there's so much power. A lot of the changes were putting more power into neutral objectives.
It's true.
The change live, though, is that turrets are worth more money.
Right.
So on 421, you get more gold to work with if you are a team that's oriented on taking down the buildings.
Right.
So some more advantage towards the sieges there.
Right, exactly. I think my answer to you is twofold. So one, the metagame, which is literally what everyone else is doing, is map control, right? The way most people are playing competitive is that. So yes, that's technically what the metagame is. Now that said, I think that it's only that way because that's what This sounds stupid, but it's what people are choosing to play, right? They're choosing to buy a lot of wards to buy sweepers to play the vision game. That said, if instead of Locket you went for, you know, second item Banner of Command, if you played the Caitlyn's of the world, right? The things that
we just haven't seen anyone try it really.
Right, yeah. You go Banner of Command, Elixir of Ruin, like, you push at 20 minutes with double Triforce, like,
yeah,
that's going to destroy the team with two dragons.
Yeah, I have actually done a couple games, Nunu and Heimerdinger together, you know, with a team that does have stuff like that, like Caitlyn and Jhin and stuff, and, you know, if you have Azir, this is one of the teams I really want to see go up against a team like Curse Academy are rolling with right now. If you have the Azir mid, Heimer top, Nunu jungle with Caitlyn and Jhin up down bottom lane, that team, like, the siege of all siege teams, I want to match that up with something like this that's a full team fight and see it played well. I want to see it just to try it out.
Yeah. Well, the charm of Azir Nunu is not lost on people, actually. I was talking to one of the teams. They're like, oh, yeah, no, it's, like, really stupid. Those things attack super fast. Well, one kill picked up already, though. Down goes Jhana. Curse Academy ready to roll this game on in. Jess is pretty well caught out. There's the Pantheon jump in. 2-0 so far. Keen, though, taking a bunch of pain, but Impaler can't do enough to him. St. Vicious will get dropped, though. Can Mash carry this fight? I think the answer is no. Hanser and Copper there. Nice play from Bunny Foo, but this is going to be all 5 kills picked up. No, only 4 for one casualty, but there are minions coming into the base right now.
All right, so it looks like, you know, this game headed towards evening up, and another long series ahead of us already, I believe, Freak. Yep. All right, Curse Academy with that map control squad.
And the map control, heavy melee, heavy move speed squad. They find the catches. They find the follow-up after the team fights. Game 1 took 50. Game 2 took only 40. Curse Academy, well in control.
Stack.
Yeah. 1-1 now in the best of 5. Both these teams know, like, they want to stay in control of this series. Obviously, the way to get in the LCS is by winning, but also knowing that if you lose, you still have that really tough road ahead.
Yeah, going into the Challenger Series, you can get into the summer split of the LCS, and you can technically still, you know, you'll still be in time for, qualifying for Worlds, and that's really the end goal for everybody, so.
That's true.
Not all is lost after this. I have to say, though, very convincing game 2 here from Curse Academy. Straightforward strategy, executed fairly well. Liquid said that his main problem was that he thought that it was a lot of nerves there for the first game. And it looked like they cleaned up a lot of the play.
I think so, yeah. Honestly, Curse Academy looked pretty good. I wasn't necessarily sold on the team comp initially because I felt like it was pretty risky, had, like, poor ways of coming back in for like a losing game. But you saw that they played the comp properly. And the thing is, when we watched, like, old Curse, like Curse the sort of prime squad back in LCS, they, like, I would see them play poke comps and then, like, get themselves stuck in a Baron pit and then, like, get engaged on and die. And they would, like, play their comp completely the wrong way. Curse Academy here never, ever, ever tried to just, like, siege a turret. They knew flat out, like, we're never going to go for this one. Cop wave cleared and then backed out every time.
I mean, well, even if you try, you're just like, this is not really working out very well. I can't actually hit the turret.
Right.
So eventually you're going to fall back into this play pattern. This is, like, a really simple strategy to go with.
Yep. But, I mean, you know, good on them to be slow about it. And, hey, they made a bunch of right choices. Well played, Curse Academy. Guys, of course, to keep the content going, we do have an interview with Dash on stage. So take it away.
Thank you, Freak. I'm standing here with Michael Slan, who's the COO of Team Coast. Another long, tough game, and unfortunately a loss there, evening up the series 1-1. Real quick, I want to get your impressions on the way the team played and how they're doing overall in the series.
I think it's a really close series, and I think that a lot of the games are going to just come down to team fights around dragons and the implied vision control from the relative team strength.
All right, sweet. Let's dive a little bit into your background. How did you get started into League? What's your connection to esports?
Preseason 1, I was on a team with Christian Rivera, I Will Dominate. He was my college roommate and one of my best friends. I quit the game and I went and moved to Las Vegas to pursue professional poker.
Sweet. So what was it then that brought you back to League of Legends to join the competitive scene?
Brandon is kind of like my little brother, and he's been around me and Christian like forever, and he needed a place to stay that wasn't Toronto with 120 ping, so I let him stay in my apartment in Las Vegas on the Strip.
Well, there you have it, friendship developing into a full-blown esports team. Now, obviously, that means then that you had Mash and Sheep on the roster at the beginning of creating this team, but beyond that, what was the process of finding the other three members of the team?
I try to evaluate the free agents that I see, and I try to put together a team that stylistically meshes and that can win.
All right. That sounds simple enough, right? Now I want to dive into the support staff, because we don't too often hear about how a team or an owner as yourself finds the managers, the coaches, the the analysts, things like that. So, you know, what are the traits you look for in those roles, and how do you go about finding them?
Mostly, I would say the biggest, most important thing for a supporting role is reliability and consistency, and also having a large fan base, which helps us to acquire sponsors.
Fantastic. Another big changeup we saw to the roster is that you went outside of the NA region to bring in Jezzes and Impaler. So, you know, what were the reasonings behind extending your reach outside of NA and over to EU?
At the times that we were changing our roster, almost, in my opinion, the strongest talent in NA was already signed to teams and rosters, and I don't poach. So when you can't find people within your own region, you have to look to other regions for the best talent.
And do you feel as well that bringing in guys from other regions can kind of help level up, say, you know, the ingenuity and like the ability of a team to perform outside of maybe the confines of the meta, as Freak was saying earlier, of the NA region?
I think it brings a level of seriousness and a level of professionalism.
All right. Now, you as an owner, as manager of the organization and the team itself, what are the challenges that you have faced, you know, from the beginning growing an organization?
Well, we definitely hit a low spot when we got relegated to Complexity. We didn't expect that, and we felt that we had a way stronger roster than them, and it was a big surprise to get relegated. But within the week, I had created us a new roster that I felt could compete.
And beyond just finding players, what else is, again, as an owner, the struggles of, you know, securing sponsorships and things like that? Like, it's a really interesting piece of the industry that we don't get to, you know, have insight into very often.
There's a lot of people that I have to thank, especially for helping me to build the team, specifically Mike at Azubu. He has been a great influence to our team and helped us. Joey at Cyberpower, he's provided us over 10 computers, and he's been a great guy and a great influence to us. Kevin Gao at Law Class, a lot of people don't talk about him, and there's been some bad press lately about it, but to be honest, they have a great website and they've sponsored tons of teams and they've helped develop our league. And lastly, I'm looking at Scott Ball at Razor, and I'm hoping that maybe he can hook us up.
All right, I love it. Well, definitely fun to watch your organization grow. They're doing quite well today. I'm going to wish them the best of luck in the rest of their series. Thank you for your time here up on the stage. We're going to send it back over to Freak and Kobe at the desk to get us into Game 3.
Thank you very much, Dash. What's up, guys? Game 3 going to be coming up in a second. Of course, the best of 5.